This project uses an approach for recovering legacy pea while minimizing crop nutrient deficiency risk. The quantitative approach makes use of the soil pea storage capacity concept originally developed in Florida just over 10 years ago. The concept, referred to as SPSC, is calculated from pea, phosphorus, iron, and aluminum in a malic 3 solution, that's in a soil test solution, and it's expected to identify sites where phosphorus application is needed for plant growth, and when pea can be mined from the crop. So it shows the difference between the two. We have two experimental field sites on two different soil types, all of which have legacy peas that could be mined. Pea mining will be by 3 year-round cropping systems, rye, silage corn, and sorghum. What we're seeing here is one of the field sites where silage corn is the cropping system. We have plots with biochar applications and plots which are controls, that is, no pea application, and we have also plots with inorganic pea applications. The pea application is applied via poultry litter biochar at the same rate as inorganic pea applications. Note that it is possible at this time to pick out plots where biochar has been applied. The one here, the one to my left, shows the biochar applied plots, and to the right is the control plots. Now, besides the height, there's a huge difference in the color of the leaves. The biochar amended plots are dark green and the others are becoming lighter in color. It appears now that the no pea plots will need to be fertilized to maintain crop productivity. Actual measurements of SPSC and tissue pea levels after each cropping cycle will confirm these visual observations. Good morning, Andressa.
Good morning, Dr. Nair.
Do you notice any difference in the corn appearance in the different treatments?
Yeah, so for now we can see that the biochar plots, the plants in this plots, are greener than the inorganic pea fertilizer plots.
By the way, was there any yield difference in year one of this project? You're right now in year two, right?
Yeah, so in the first year, when analyzing the data, we saw a slightly difference in the yield for the corn silage in the biochar plots compared to the inorganic pea and the control plots.
You had applied all other fertilizers other than pea at the same rate for all the plots. That includes the biochar plots, the phosphorus applied plots, and your control. Am I right on that?
Yes.
By the way, how were the fertilizers applied?
So all the fertilizers were broadcasted, and the biochar and all the other fertilizers were applied after 2 weeks of the planting. And we also applied nitrogen and potassium again after 40 days of planting, or 2 weeks after the first fertilization.
Okay. Could the difference in the yield that you noticed last time and the difference you expect this time be due to the excess nitrogen and other nutrients in the biochar itself? Because you added those nutrients and you have not accounted for them except for phosphorus, right?
Yeah. So we need to find that out. So when we harvest the corn, we're gonna analyze plant tissue for nitrogen and phosphorus and see if this biochar amended plots have a difference in those nutrients compared to the other ones.
Would you be analyzing nitrogen and other nutrients in the soil as well?
Yeah, sure. So to make sure that it could be an excess of these nutrients in the biochar plots, we have to analyze the soil and plant tissue.
Okay. How much of biochar did you add to each of these plots? I believe you have 6 reps for the biochar plots as well as for the inorganic fertilized and your control plots. Am I right on that?
Yes, so there are 6 replicates. We applied 45 kilograms per hectare inorganic phosphorus in the inorganic pea plots, and the equivalent amount of total phosphorus in the biochar was added to the biochar plots. And this was about 750 kilograms per hectare of biochar addition.
Oh, but that's a very small amount, isn't it?
Yes, but biochar contains a large amount of phosphorus, about 35,000 milligrams of phosphorus per kilogram of biochar. However, this total phosphorus is not all extracted by the soil test solution, such as Malic 3. On the other hand, inorganic P application means that the total phosphorus applied is 100% soluble.
Ah, so what happens to the excess P that's not removed by the crop?
Well, the excess phosphorus could be lost from the soil, causing eutrophication of the nearby water bodies.
And Teresa, you mentioned that not all P in the biochar was Malic 3 extractable. So what happens to the remaining P, total P in that biochar material?
So cultivated biochar was chosen for field application because it contains a sparingly soluble calcium phosphate mineral. So it is likely that some phosphorus is held within the biochar that might be released over time.
You mean like a slow release P fertilizer?
Possibly, but we need to find out if this is true.
And how do we do that?
I'm going to show you how we're going to find this out.
In year two, the biochar and inorganic pea plots have been subdivided. Biochar was added only to one part of the initial biochar plots, and the inorganic pea fertilizer was added to just one half of the original inorganic pea plots.
So what do you expect would happen?
The crops in the original biochar added plots would continue to flourish. When biochar application is stopped, plant growth will be maintained because of the residual phosphorus held in the biochar. Fertilization is stopped, perhaps plant would continue to thrive, assuming the SPSC is still negative in these plots, and pea mining could continue.
Thank you, Andressa.
Thank you.
Appreciate your help in this one, explaining these complicated system you have here.
Thank you. Thank you.